So now that we've talked a bit about the Search Stream Gang test driver program, and we've talked about the Search Stream Gang abstract class that serves as the basis for all the different implementations, let's go ahead and take a look at one of the implementations. And we'll start off with the simplest one, arguably the simplest one, depends on your point of view, which is one that just uses good old Java for loops. So this implementation extends Search Stream Gang, and we call it search with sequential loops. And as you can see here, its constructor passes up the parameters to the superclass where they get stored away in some fields. And then its entry point method, which is where all the fun begins, is the process stream method. We saw process stream earlier when we looked down here at initiate stream, where as you can see, that's where we started the process in motion and we timed it. So this is an example of a particular implementation of process stream, just happens to be the one that uses a loop. And this is the kind of code, if you're programming with Java today before you popped into the beauty of functional programming and streams and all this good stuff we're covering here, you probably would have written code pretty much like this. I wrote code like this a lot in my life. So we make ourselves a new array list, which is a list of search results. We'll talk more about what that means later. And then for each of the character sequences in our input, in other words, for each work of Shakespeare in this case, we're going to go ahead and call the process input method on that input string. And we're going to take the results that come back from the process input method, which is defined down here, and we're going to add it to this list of search results. And when we're all done, we return the list of search results. And I'll come back and we'll kind of, you know, talk about this code and say, is it good, is it bad in a second. But before we do that, before we evaluate it, here's process input. Process input is going to do, it's going to look up the phrases, the famous barred phrases for each work of Shakespeare. So Hamlet, Julius Caesar, Macbeth, Twelfth Night, whatever. We go ahead and we get the title, which is the first piece of the input string, and we strip it off. And then we go ahead and get the work itself. And then we're going to make ourselves a list of search results using a new array list. And now for each phrase to find, so for, you know, get thee to a nunnery, or to thy own self be true, or my horse, my kingdom for a horse, whatever the phrase is, we're going to go ahead and call this method called search for phrase. And that is going to go ahead and search in the input, in the work of Shakespeare, for that particular phrase. And it'll give back something called a search results object. And a search results object just keeps track of how many times, if at all, that phrase occurred in that input string. So it might occur 0 times, it might occur 1 time, it might occur 5 times, depending on what you're searching for. And if we ended up with something that was had some results, in other words, we found at least one hit, we add that to our list of search results. And then when we're all done, we go ahead and we return the list of search results. And then the last thing here is search for phrase. So that takes a phrase and an input string. It makes us an array list for a list of search results, result objects. A result object just keeps track of the index where the phrase occurred, if it occurred at all. And then we do a bunch of regular expression coolness, where we're going to go ahead and take the phrase we're looking for and get rid of extra spaces. We just have one white space between each of the words. And we're going to quote question marks to avoid problems. And then we go ahead and make ourselves a regular expression out of that string. And we do it in a way that's case insensitive, so uppercase and lowercase are ignored. And we also can search across lines by using the dot all pattern. And now we go ahead and make ourselves a pattern matcher, which basically takes that regular expression and connects it to the input, which is a work of Shakespeare. And then while we've found anything, while pattern or phrase matcher.find doesn't return false, we're going to go ahead and figure out where we found a match in that regular expression, for that regular expression in the string, and we're going to add that into our result list. And when we're all done, we're going to take the result list we got back, which might or might not be empty, and we're going to go ahead and make a new search results object that says basically what was the phrase we were looking for, in what work of Shakespeare did it occur, and where were the indices, if any. And you can see that when that comes back up here, then if it actually got a hit, it adds that to the list. So this is sort of the, you know, this is the baseline version. This is the version that we're all familiar with. If you program Java, even if you haven't programmed Java, you're probably familiar with this basic form of programming. And this is good old object-oriented imperative style programming. And therein lies the tricky part. And the tricky part here is that, first of all, we're using loops, not the end of the world, but we have to remember to allocate our list of search results, or our list of search results, or our results list, or whatever. We have to make sure that we allocate it with new array list. And I can't tell you the number of times in my life when I have forgotten to do that, and my code is blown up with a null pointer exception. I'm like, what the heck's going on here? Well, inevitably what was going on there was I forgot to allocate that. So that's a very, very common mistake. Many people make it. I make it even though I know better. At this point, I've done it a million times. I keep making that same darn mistake. And so one of the things we're going to see when we start talking about using streams and functional programming is there no longer is any need to explicitly initialize these types of variables. It's done automatically by the terminal operations that come baked into the streams framework. So that's a plus. Another problem that you see down here is this. We have an if statement. Now, a for loop with one if statement, not the end of the world, but it would be nice if we didn't have to have an if statement at all. It'd be nice to get rid of conditionals. It'd be nice if we could get rid of explicit iteration. So as we'll see, as we go through these examples and we start looking at the other strategies in subsequent classes, the streams mechanism is going to allow us to get rid of looping. It's going to get rid of the need to initialize these variables. It's going to get rid of the need to have if statements. And so our code becomes very linear. You read it from top to bottom. Once you know how to read it, it's very simple. I think it's very simple, at least, and very intuitive. You can pretty much understand something in a single linear pass. Whereas if you're playing runtime system, which is what you do with a loop and an if statement, you have to keep thinking, okay, have I finished with my loop? Is the if statement true or false? What happens? And you have to kind of iterate in your brain multiple times to see what it's doing. And then, of course, the final thing that makes it more problematic to use the sequential loops version is we've gotten something we call the accumulator anti-pattern. And if you watch the videos, I talk about the accumulator anti-pattern. That was a term that I first heard from Brian Goetz, who's one of the chief Java architects, talking about what's wrong with writing code like this. And what's wrong with writing code like this is we explicitly hard code in the concurrency model, which is non-existent. And if you want to add anything else that runs in a multi-threaded way, you're applying a lot of additional work to make this work in a more concurrent or parallel way. So it kind of goes back to the earlier discussion we had about how much effort is required to do this. Now, one of the things that's tricky about this, and you'll see this when we start talking about the more advanced implementation strategies, the advanced implementation strategies are concurrent with respect to the process stream logic, each of the different works of Shakespeare's processed in parallel. They're concurrent with respect to the phrases defined. Each phrase is run in parallel. And they're even going to be parallel with respect to looking up in an input string to find where the matches occur. That can run in parallel. And making all those things run in parallel with the streams model is actually fairly straightforward. Making all that stuff run in parallel using Java threads, you'd lose your mind. It's so complicated. And you'd give up after just a few attempts at trying to do this. You'd say, okay, fine, I'm just going to use one model. And the problem with using one model is that if you run on different hardware platforms with different numbers of cores, like if you end up with a platform with 256 cores or 1,000 cores or whatnot, you want to have maximal parallelism in your code. And you're very unlikely to take the time to do that using this more traditional imperative object-oriented approach. Whereas with the functional approach using streams and other things we're going to talk about, it's really easy to make those changes and you can maximize or max out your parallelism, which makes it possible to take better advantage of the underlying hardware in ways that you could do if someone paid you enough money and gave you enough pizza and diet soda, but you'd probably be unlikely to do unless you really had a good reason. So that's pragmatically speaking where you can get the win for 85% of the applications you're likely to build. And only when you're doing the very small percentage of things where you've got to get in there and optimize the inner loop and write it in assembly code and so on and so forth, is this approach maybe not the best way to go. So we'll talk a lot more about those things. And in subsequent sessions, we're going to go through all these other strategies and pick them apart and talk about them and get a chance to kind of compare and contrast all the different ways of doing things. But this is kind of fun because it's kind of like a Rosetta Stone, if you will, where you can compare and contrast literally all these different mechanisms and then compare them in an apples to apples way in terms of their performance.